Well, it has been an extraordinary adventure and an amazing journey. I think it's only just started. There's many sliding doors in Australian political history in the last 5, 10, 15 years which have led to the community independence and what happened with the 2022 election. But for me, it was climate change. It was my son's distress on watching David Attenborough Life on Earth shows. It was increasing frustration with a government that didn't represent me and a government of which I was embarrassed. When Scott Morrison went to the COP in Glasgow, it was a national embarrassment. Deeply, deeply, viscerally frustrated with our previous government. May 21st, 2022, I and a number of other community independents were elected to Parliament. Many people after the election said to us, look, you haven't got the balance of power, what are you going to do? And then we started to sort of exercise our powers. I actually had a glimpse of what we could do before the election last year, where I'd had a distressing experience at the pre-poll where a lady had come up to me in tears because her husband wasn't going to be able to vote because he'd just tested positive for COVID. And she asked me if I could help. So I asked her who he was going to vote for. Not really. No. So I went back to the office. I said to him, that's really bad. You know, this is terrible. And then we realised that other people were calling us, can you help? And then things being things and the people of the Kuyong campaign being who they are, that snowballed within about 3 hours to us having got the constitutional lawyers involved, and we prepared ourselves to mount a federal court challenge to it. And within 2 hours, we'd collected $120,000. And the next day, Alex Hawke changed the law, which was extraordinary. You know, we were standing at pre-poll on the Friday saying, if we could do this before we're even elected, what could we do after? It gave us a real sense of possibility. And so I guess after the election, what has happened? Well, in the end, the Albanese government had the balance of power and they could enact the Climate Change Act. But they brought to us a bill which was, it was okay, but it wasn't great. And so I and a number of other independents moved amendments to it, which they didn't accept, but some of them got up in the Senate. But the next big piece of legislation that came up was this year, the safeguards mechanism, and that also was okay, but not great. Because the Liberal Party, in their wisdom, said no, it meant that we got to debate it, put in a huge number of amendments. Some of them got up in the House and some of them got up in the Senate. It wasn't perfect, but it was better. And exactly the same thing happened last week with the nature repair market. And what we've learned is that that is our role at this point in time, is to act as the sensible centrists, the pragmatists who will actually come to the table and debate bills with the government in a way that the opposition is not doing. They've actually left a space for us to waltz into, and we have waltzed into it with great gusto, that we are keeping the bastards honest. And what we've learned is that even if you don't have the balance of power, you can change things. You know, you realise that there are levers that you can pull. Actually, in my second week, the Governor-General had received a whole lot of money from Scott Morrison for a really dodgy grant to set up a leadership fund. We were trying to work out how we could stop that, and we worked out that there's this thing called delegated legislation. And if something's been before the House for 10 sitting days or fewer, you can stop it. And we did that. And you could just see people go, what? You know. And we thought, well, that was fun. What else, what else can we stop? I have found the role incredibly engaging, incredibly interesting. I think we're only just beginning to work out what we can do. So we've had the Climate Change Act, we've had the Safeguards Act and the Nature Repair Market. The next 6 to 12 months, the very, very big piece is the EPPC Act, which is massive. That's your water trigger. That's protection of species. It's actually protection of heritage buildings as well, strangely enough. It's a whole lot of different things that will come under this one massive, massive bill, which I think for this government will be defining in terms of their climate record, because so far everything's been a little bit less good than what we hoped for. And my job and the job of the other independents is to try and improve it. Because what we've seen is that this government, although it has some really good things to do and it's got good intentions, is hampered for whatever reason in what it's putting on the table in terms of legislation. And so what we're doing now is kind of just the beginning. A That is actually one of the more difficult things, which is the fact that you spend a third of your time in Canberra, which is like another world, because you are really in an incredible bubble. And during those days, you know, you'll start with a breakfast, but it's often three breakfasts. You might be a couple of health groups or a disability group or First Nations group or a climate group. So it's really frenetic and it's full on and it's incredibly intense. It's so interesting. There's so much to learn. But it's not the real world. You come back to Kooyong, and in fact, Kooyong is the reason why I'm here. I care about the community. I want to be in the community. That's the bit I really enjoy and that's the fun bit, but that's not the Canberra bit. There's a great insecurity because we get so much negativity about, you know, the transition, and opposition is so consistent in pushing back about these things. I mean, it's remarkable how they've rediscovered the potential of nuclear, the potential for, you know, the transition to be non-seamless is really worrying for people. But I actually think it's jobs, and I think that lobbying groups and the money that fossil fuel companies give to the major parties influences their decision making. I do. Yeah. Now, we can't have new fossil fuel, we can't have new gas or coal if we're going to avoid 1.5. I don't know if I'm going to avoid 1.5. The frustrating thing, and sometimes you just can't work out why they won't affect the change that they need to affect. It's not that they don't know, it's just that for whatever reason they won't go there until they're forced to, almost. And that's what we kind of have to do. So Beetaloo is frightening. Somewhere between 1,000 and 6,000 fracking wells in the Northern Territory, the gas from which will go to Middle Arm and then be exported. The First Nations people don't want that. We were going to have a day of action in Canberra on the 8th of August. And the frightening things about that fracking are what they'll do to the aquifers of the Northern Territory. So there's a real danger of a significant pollution and then loss of water supply to large parts of the territory, and then the direct and indirect effects of the fracking itself. They're going to produce hydrogen there, 3 km from Palmerston. It's like an accident could be disastrous, quite apart from what it will do to Darwin Harbour and what it will do to the water supplies of the Northern Territory. I just get furious even thinking about it. It has to be stopped. Oh, look, I think they're all pretty good at hiding it, but if you look at the donations to the major political parties last year, the donations to the parties were really significant, to the Labor Party as well as the Liberal Party. Mm-hmm. And we're talking IPIA, we're talking Santos, we're talking Woodside, we're talking the Minerals Council. There's money on the table there. And that's just the stuff you know about. And I suspect that that's the tip of the iceberg. The government, when it gave $1.9 billion to Middle Arm, essentially was putting money into infrastructure, gas, to be processed and shipped offshore. That's an active subsidy to new fossil fuel activities. There's heaps of that going on, and I don't think we even see the half of it. I don't see the lobbying, but I know it's happening because you can see it affecting the decisions that are being made. We've been like frogs. We've sort of been slowly boiled and not realised that the water was getting hotter. You know, if you call corruption the use of public money for personal or political gain, the extent of the corruption that's becoming apparent is frightening, and we haven't even talked about robo-debt. And so the integrity piece is really important. So we'll have a National Anti-Corruption Commission, but that's just part of it. You know, then we need reform of things like our lobbying rules, and we need donation reform, and we need a whole other raft of integrity measures, and the crossbench are working on those. Look, one thing I think we all learnt last year that we didn't quite appreciate was the power of community. And I don't think any of us saw it coming, what happened last year. I'd certainly never thought that Kooyong would mobilise in the way that it did at the last federal election. But it wasn't just Kooyong, you know, there's a whole lot of different electorates where that happened. And in some of them, we were successful, in some we weren't. What people have to take away from that is the ability for all of us to affect change when we feel strongly about something. I've learnt politicians do react to pressure, and that's what all of you can do. You've done it already, and you should not forget what you did last time. Thank you.